get all emotional here. Kindness is what you literally say. I was born. I was my best friend when we grew up. So, I'll just start with something very interesting I saw. A pencil maker once told me the pencils before he put them in the box. He gave them 5 things to remember. Everything you do will always leave a mark. You can always correct the mistakes you make. What is important is what's inside you. In life, you will undergo painful sharpening, which will only make you better. And finally, to be the best pencil, you must always allow yourself to be held and guided by the hand that holds you. Great, tremendous lesson from life, tremendous lesson from marriage. And you know, sometimes in life, things get very difficult. And we look at it like a mountain. You look up and you say, I could never, ever accomplish this. Or I can't get over this specific burden in my life. And the truth is, it really may be impossible. But Hashem just wants us to try. And Hashem tells us, Ma'ata ma'ala nischar yimul asisa. I will give you the schar just for trying. And doing it, I will give it a star as if you actually accomplished whether you did or not. This is a famous story about this Israeli soldier who finished his years in the army, and he went with a few friends to Africa. And in one instance, they slept overnight in a tent, and a snake wrapped itself around one of the soldiers. And he awakened his other friends. He couldn't move. And snakes have patience. They can wait for hours and hours. And one of the soldiers finally told him, says, why did you say Shema Yisrael? And I've heard the story a few times. The soldier says Shema Yisrael, and with that, the snake went away. And so after, one of the soldiers went to the site we're going, and he repeated the story. So the spy was going to ask him, I don't understand. After such a story, how could you not be from it? So he says, well, you see, the story never really happened to me. It happened to my friend. Had the story happened to me, it would be from today. It's a tremendous lesson how closed-minded people are. And you see this opportunity that this soldier had to change his whole life, and yet he didn't take this opportunity. And we see the same concept in this week's parsha, last week's parsha. Where Hashem is clearly telling Paro, he says, yo, give it up. Let the kid go. And the sorcerers, Paro's sorcerers, is telling him that this is clearly Yah Hashem. We can't do the things that they're doing, specifically by the Makkah of life. And yet Paro couldn't give up. And what's talk of Shem? Is that it gets to a point in the person's life where there's almost no bechira. Some people have such a hard time admitting that they were wrong that they'll die before they admit that they're wrong. And I have to tell you that Yanki and Miriam did a tremendous job bringing up Chaim. He was a very difficult kid, I have to tell you. One of the great things I have to tell you, certain things that Chaim, even as a kid, very few kids have this virtue. I'll give you a couple of examples. I remember this one day on Chol HaMoed, we were traveling to this place called, I can't remember. Not Rocky Horse Ranch. Connection. Okay. And it was in the Catskills on Chol HaMoed.
Ring Homestead.
So, as we're driving, he said, you know, it's Ring Homestead is an exit 116. And Chaim said, no, it's not, it's exit 120. He said, no, it's exit 116. And I was so sure of myself. But driving, and sure enough, it's exit 120. Now, I do have a hard time saying that I'm wrong. But I tell you, if I was right, I would have probably done something like, ha! Chaim, in a very cool manner, didn't say one word. He knew he was right, and I knew that he was right. So there was a long time we were driving, we were on a bridge, and I insisted it was the Verrazano Bridge, and Chaim insisted it was the George Washington Bridge. No, it's the Verrazano Bridge, it's the George Washington Bridge. Abba, what bridge is this? It's the George Washington Bridge. Oops. Not a sound from Chaim. Hey, Chaim really always had my back throughout the years. I don't know which stories I should say, which stories I shouldn't say. I'll allow myself to say a few stories. So this one time, nothing major, but still, it was snowing, and I begged my mother to give me a day off. We were seven. Please, Mom, I want to play in the snow. It's not your race, Yaakov. Doesn't have school, the Vini Shiva does have school. She gave it. She let me stay home. The next day, I came to Yeshiva, and the Rebbe asked me, do you speak Hebrew? How do I explain this? Silence. He asked me again, and he asked me again. Finally, we all turned to Chaim. Says, Chaim, I, do you speak Hebrew? No, thing. And I was sure Chaim was going to slip. And I tell you, he had my back. Another time, we were on the bus, and as kids, sometimes I got you a show. We were all embarrassed, we're on the show, but what's my show? Nothing can show me more than a show I got you. The next day we come to Yeshiva, and one of the kids, one of the kids wakes up, he's bored. He wakes up, Rebbe, next one of the bus, Ellie, Tzvi, Yelim, and this one and that one, Harukatin Dahayim. Finally, it was quiet. My name wasn't called, and one kid said, "Then don't be okay." We got punished. The mother got panicked with us. That night, also the Rebbe wanted to know where his own family is. I think nobody remembered that at all. So we came up that night, and I went to Uncle Yaki's house, and so he sat down with us. I'm like, "Tell me the truth. Who really started?" And I said, "Not me. You should know. For sure." No. Then Chaim said, okay, now I can say it was double up. And then we also had another Rebbe. He had this habit. I'll tell you, I don't know where to get this from, but when he didn't know where the place was in Chimish, Chimish Arasha, he used to call up the boy, and he used to go, From the very few times that I didn't have a place. The Rebbe called up Chaim and says, Zalach, I'm shlugging with the shtekker of the head now. I was terrified of the shtekker. And I remember thinking, Chaim, please, 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 with the head. And Chaim said, shlugging with the head. You know, I remember growing up, Yaki was divorced.
That Rebbe ended up getting divorced. His wife went off to Derek.
I was just reminded me of a story. Such. This one Shabbos Friday night, we were praying. I'm telling you what Chaim that is. And Chaim fell back and he hit his head on the steam. And it was frightening. I was maybe 3-4 years old. Yaki, I'm sure you remember the story. And the one thing I remember Yaki grabbed, he took control, he grabbed Chaim and he started running. And I'll just never forget as a little kid looking up at Yaki and saying, wow.
What a hero.
That made such a rush for me. I tell you, I don't know what I would do without an Uncle Yaki and very young. I can't imagine life without them. The respect that I have of both of them. And when you have a one-on-one talk with Yankee, both Yankee and Miriam, and I've had quite a few talks with Yankee, he's very, very passionate about any subject. You can really learn a lot from both Yankee and Miriam. And with that, I want to wish everybody a Mazel Tov. Mazel Tov to Chaim, my best friend, my aunt and uncle, Houston parents, grandparents, and I specifically want to mention Bobby Pollack, who I'll never ever forget. Tremendous woman, and I did have, even though I wasn't a grandchild, I felt like I had a special connection with her in specific ways. But with that, I wish everybody a Mazel Tov. Shalom Yisrael. All
right, Mazel Tov. 11 minutes and 5 seconds. The speech. Good speech. Good speech, Toby. I'm talking into the phone right here. Yeah. 11 minutes and 5 seconds.
How much? How
11
long?
Minutes oh and 5 seconds. Big drushing. All right.